Did you know that there is an English accent that is not British and it's not American? It's something in between. Yes, that's right. It's a real thing and it's called the Transatlantic accent or the Mid-Atlantic accent. As if the inhabitants came from an island in the middle of the Atlantic. If you're learning English and you can't decide whether to learn British or American pronunciation, well, why not have both at the same time? Today on Let Them Talk TV, you will learn the fascinating history of the transatlantic accent. And then, with the help of my friend and colleague Jack, we'll dive into its phonetics and we'll teach you how to speak it with lots of example sentences for you to try. You won't want to miss this, so stay tuned. When I was a kid, I used to watch lots of old American movies on TV. When I say old, I mean old, from the 1930s, the 1940s, the 1950s. And to this day, most of my favorite movies are from this era. It's referred to as the Golden Age of Hollywood. But take a look at this clip and tell me, where do you think the actors are from?
Mr. Archer was so alive yesterday, so solid and hearty.
Stop it. You know what he was doing? Those are the chances we take.
Was he married?
Yeah, with 10,000 insurance, no children, and a wife that didn't like him.
Now, Humphrey Bogart is clearly American, but what about the woman? That's Mary Astor, and she was American too. But doesn't she sound different to Humphrey Bogart? Doesn't she sound kind of British? This always baffled me as a kid. Why do some American actors sound kind of British in these old films? It was only recently that I found out that what they were speaking was the transatlantic accent. And in addition to Mary Astor, some of the biggest stars of this period had this accent. Stars such as Betty Davis.
I wonder if we were both going to say the same thing.
Vincent Price.
Do you think your wife killed herself?
No. She was murdered. By one of you.
Katharine Hepburn.
Hello.
Hello. Fancy seeing you here.
Orange juice? Certainly.
Don't tell me you've forsaken your beloved whiskey and whiskies.
Orson Welles.
Would you really feel any pity if one of those dots stopped moving forever? If I offered you £20,000 for every dot that stopped, would you really, old man, tell me to keep my money? Or would you calculate how many dots you could afford to spin?
And Cary Grant, or maybe not Cary Grant. He's a special case, and I'll come to him in a minute.
Yes, I wish you hadn't done that, Hilly.
Done what?
Divorce me. Makes a fella lose all faith in himself. Almost gives him a feeling he wasn't wanted.
Oh, now look, Junior, that's what divorces are for.
Nonsense. You've got an old-fashioned idea. Divorce is something that lasts forever, till death do us part. Why, divorce doesn't mean anything nowadays, Hilly. Just a few words mumbled over you by a judge.
And many, many more. But how did this accent come about, and why do you rarely hear it these days? Let's have a look at the history. The transatlantic accent is a learned accent. It's completely made up. There are no native speakers of this accent, and there never have been. There's no region in the United States where they speak with this accent. You'll find a Midwestern accent and a Southern accent, but nowhere do they speak transatlantic. Having said that, it was an accent which was adopted in a number of elite private schools on the northeastern seaboard of the United States. And the accent around Boston shares some features of a British accent, such as non-roticity, that is, that you don't roll the R's. In most US accents, you'd say, for example, bird, excuse my bad American accent, but in British English, the R simply lengthens the vowel, so you'd say bird. And some speakers of the Boston accent do this. It all started in the beginning of the 20th century when the idea of a standard American accent of prestige was introduced by Australian phonetician William Tilley, who taught at Columbia University from 1918 until his death in 1935. Tilley had a vision that there should be a standard form of English speech for the educated elite that sounded the same throughout the English-speaking world. It should be free of regional dialect. So if you met someone of good society, as they say, from New York, London, or Melbourne, they would sound the same. His idea was for a universal English. It was a kind of an Esperanto of the English language. Secondly, this accent should be intelligible to anyone, anywhere in the world, stripped away of regional baggage. It could be understood by everyone. If you've ever struggled to understand a Texan or a Sydneysider or a Glaswegian or anyone with a strong regional accent, it's quite appealing, the idea of having one accent that we can all comprehend. Thirdly, they believe that it should be the most beautiful form of accent. Taking all this into consideration, he based the pronunciation on a modified upper class British accent with some New England speech patterns. He called this accent World English, and Tilly became extremely influential. He was considered by his followers as a visionary. Many of those who enrolled in his classes spread his message. They included teachers at elite private schools and actors. The accent was strongly advocated at these schools between the 1920s and the 1940s. And some of those who learnt the accent at school include Franklin Roosevelt, Eleanor Roosevelt, Gore Vidal, Norman Mailer, and many more. One of Tilly's disciples was Edith Wharton Skinner, who was a vocal coach who taught classes to actors and was author of Speak with Distinction, 1942. Her work influenced a whole generation of actors of both stage and screen. She codified the accent in writing. She called it good American speech, and she referred to it as the appropriate American pronunciation for classics and elevated text. If anyone wants to read more about this, I'll put a link to her book in the description. Her methods were adopted by theatre and drama schools across the US. Furthermore, at the time, the proponents believed that they were not only offering the best and clearest accent, but also that Hollywood was offering something universal, a way of speaking that belonged to everyone, but came from nowhere. Now, of course, if it were a gangster movie or a movie set in a working class neighborhood, then a local accent was to be expected. But if you were performing a classic or something more theatrical, or perhaps Shakespeare even, then the transatlantic accent was seen as more appropriate than a general American accent. What happened to this accent and where did it go? In the second half of the 20th century, the accent declined in popularity amongst the elite classes, and filmmakers made more movies about how people spoke in the real world and accents that belonged somewhere rather than nowhere. However, even in the second half of the 20th century and the 21st century, you still hear this accent from time to time. And here are a few examples.
If you're in love, that is something very intense and generally very brief, as it's been most people's experience. You don't live with the person you're in love with, I should think. At least I've known very few cases of it.
You mean it's an arrangement, a convenience for you?
No, it's just you live with a friend, that's all.
The people are basically trustworthy. Frazier, the person who has your car keys asked you to meet him here knowing you'd bring your car?
Now, before you launch into one of your little paranoid riffs, my car happens to be moving down the street!
Your power's a weak, old man.
Excellent. But put a little more apple in my cheek.
When you talk about this accent, the first name that comes to mind is Cary Grant. Cary Grant was one of the biggest stars in Hollywood in his day. But he didn't have this accent exactly. You see, Cary Grant was born in Britain, in Bristol to be precise, and his real name was Archibald Leach. And he moved to the US when he was 16 years old. He picked up an American accent, but never completely. And he sounds half British and half American. However, he didn't study the transatlantic accent. It was his natural way of speaking. and it's quite unique. It's always fascinating to listen to Cary Grant, to hear that weird mishmash of British and American accent, but it's not a classic transatlantic accent.
Is he as good as you say?
Oh, he's better.
And what does he want with you?
Oh, now you got me.
Thank you, Mildred. Okay. Oh, I am sorry, Hildy. I suppose Bruce, what's his name?
Baldwin.
I suppose he opens doors for you.
He does. And when he's with the lady, he takes his hat off.
Oh, I am sorry.
And when he walks with the lady, he waits for her.
Oh, well, in that case.
Allow me.
When practicing the transatlantic accent, you can play with it because it doesn't belong anywhere. But yes, it has been codified, but not all the speakers spoke in the same way. There are guidelines, but there is really no right or wrong way as long as you sound mid-Atlantic. It is a flexible accent. And when watching old films, you'll hear, for example, some transatlantic speakers saying not the British way, while others say not the American way. And that's the fun of it. You can play around with the accent and find what you feel comfortable with or what you like. For the tutorial, I've invited Jack, who has a Scottish accent, so quite different to mine. But because there are no native speakers of the transatlantic accent, anybody can claim it from wherever you are in the world, and you can do that too. So if you're ready, let's go. I'm going to go through some of the rules, mm-hmm. and I'm going to ask you to reproduce some of the sentences. Then afterwards, you two, we're going to do a little dialogue. Transatlantic accent is non-rhotic. Now, the Scottish accent, I think is your accent is a little bit rhotic. Rhotic means rolling the R's. So in American English, you'd say words like third and mother. I don't know very well. Apologies for my bad American accent. Car, but in British English and in the transatlantic English, you'd say mother.
Well, mother, we're hooked.
Heard, third, car. I'll say the sentence, just repeat after me. Our mother heard a third car.
Our mother heard a third car.
Very good. And how would you say it in your Scottish accent?
Our mother heard a third car.
Oh yes, you have a rhotic. You see, our accents are different. Yeah. So that's interesting. But the transatlantic, you do not roll the R's. The exception could be sometimes you roll the R at the beginning of a word, like you might say, really, or a word like that. This is really, this is rubbish. The other thing about the transatlantic accent is there is no intrusive R. This is when you put an R sound between two vowels to make it easier to say, well, at least for people like myself, so who don't like to put too many vowels together. So for example, I saw a film. Now my accent, I would put the intrusive R, I saw a film. But in the transatlantic accent, there's never an intrusive R. Can you say that?
Yeah. I saw a film.
Very good, very good. And Natasha is late, not that Natasha is late. Natasha is late.
Natasha is late.
Do very well, okay. However, there is a linking R, and this is when a word ends in an R sound, and then you do pronounce the R onto the next word. So for example, there are a lot of people, okay? Or
Peter is late.
Peter is late.
Peter is late.
Should do that again, right, this is the whole point.
Yeah. Peter is late.
No, Peter is late.
Peter is late.
Peter is late.
Peter is late.
Okay, now you try it. Very good. Next, we have these parts are all more aristocratic English, I would say.
Yeah.
We'll come to the American parts later, but this is all sort of quite aristocratic sounding, posh English. So words ending in an R have a strong, sharp schwa sound. So you'd say mother, matter, Later. Okay, not mother. It doesn't go on. It stops sharply. Now, the WH sound, that's very interesting because it is pronounced. Now, there is what's called the wine distinction when you have two words which I say the same. Wine, W-H-I-N-E, and wine, W-I-N-E. Is it the same in your Scottish accent? Is it said the same?
Wine, yeah.
The same. I think so, yeah. But not in the transatlantic accent. The W-H words are pronounced. So you'd say wine and wine, and why, what. What are you doing here? Do you want to try it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you want to try it?
What are you doing here?
What is the matter, Jack?
What is the matter?
Why are you interrupting me?
Why are you interrupting me?
I cannot prophesy. I cannot tell you when or where the United Nations are going to strike next.
What about Bill? What about Bill?
Next we have the big ooh sound, the very rounded ooh sound. Okay, words like boot. So I say boot.
And
afternoon.
German.
Yeah, exactly. afternoon, root, soon. But in this transatlantic, it would be boot. Afternoon, root, do. I do like to see you in the afternoon. Try a sentence of any kind.
I do like to see Sue in the afternoon.
Very good. Very good. Okay. I hope you're practicing at home.
How do you do, my dear?
U sound is a U sound that sometimes is changed in British English to a J or sometimes a CH. I'll give you an example, you see what I mean. So you have the word D-U-K-E. Now I would say like a J, Duke, but in, or D-U-T-Y, I'd say duty, like a J. But in this transatlantic accent, that's always pronounced like a, kind of like a D-Y. Duty, or duty. Excuse me. Duty. And Duke, and Tuesday. Okay, yeah. Do you want to try it?
The call of duty.
Exactly, thank you. Thank you.
I am prepared under my constitutional duty.
Now, words ending in Y. Now, in British English and standard American English, words ending in Y are pronounced E. I'm happy to have the gravy. But in the transatlantic accent, it's pronounced I. So I'm happy to have the gravy. I'm really happy to have the gravy.
I'm really happy to have the gravy.
You see what I mean? That's very aristocratic, and you still hear that in aristocratic.
Since this corner druggist at my elbow tells me that I shall be confined to this mouldy mortuary for at least another 10 days, due entirely to your stupidity and negligence, I shall have to carry on my activities as best I can. I shall require the exclusive use of this room, as well as that drafty sewer which you call the library.
Now, this is the T sound, sometimes between vowels in American English. This should be easy for you because this is very typically British, so this won't pose a problem. But the T sound in American English often sounds like a D, like in words like Saturday, later, water. But in the transatlantic accent, it's pronounced in the British way as a T. The T's are always T's. So Saturday. Oh, Saturday, I should say. Saturday, later, waterfall. So later on Saturday, at the better waterfall. You can think of
later that. On Saturday, at the waterfall.
Okay, good. Now we'll come to one or two of the vowels which are often pronounced in the American way, okay? So we've got to be a bit more American here. So, for example, the rot vowel, which in British English is oh, like in not, hot, rot, bot, lot. In the transatlantic accent, you'd pronounce it in the American way, ah, so nut, I'm not hot, I'm not hot. I'm not hot a lot. Probably not doing it too well, but that's the closest I can get. Do you want to try it?
I'm not hot a lot.
Okay. Okay. The R sound in English becomes an A sound. Like, for example, in British English, you say can't.
Mm-hmm.
I think Scottish English too.
Can't.
Can't. Okay, mm-hmm. Slightly different. You see the difference. There is a slight difference, considerable difference between the accents.
Mm-hmm.
But in American English, it's can't. Mm-hmm. So, bath, they would say bath, I would say bath. Can't, I'd say aren't, they say aunt. All, they'd say all. So, for example, the sentence I've got here, all my aunts can't take a bath, it's awful.
All my aunts can't take a bath, it's awful.
Why, Connor, they're almost poetry.
Well, don't kid yourself, they are.
I can't make you out at all now.
Really? I thought I was easy.
So did I. But you're not.
Okay, very good. Right, that's great. Jack, mm-hmm. You're doing pretty well.
Okay.
But now we have a little dialogue.
Oh, wow.
Which we're going to do in the transatlantic accent. Okay. All right? It's just a little dialogue.
So the first dialogue in, I don't know, 60 years.
Yeah, or something like that. Something like that, yeah. Hello, Joshua.
Oh, hello, Father. What are you doing here on a Tuesday afternoon? Why aren't you with Mother?
Mother is with Aunt Agatha and Uncle Toby.
Is she?
What's the matter? Can't I see my son when I want to?
Whenever you come here alone, it's because you're angry.
Well, yes. It's about Tara and you. It's my duty to tell you that she's not right for you. She's not in your class.
That's right. Tara is my fiancée. I'm going to marry her. Kindly stay out of my affairs, Father, and stop whining.
Joshua, she's just a gold digger. And she's cold stupid. Everybody knows that.
Well, such slanders. I know her well, and you hardly know her at all, Father.
To hardly know her is to know her well.
You have no right to say that. How dare you? You really are intolerable, Father. Get out of my house immediately.
Okay, I'll leave. But consider yourself disinherited.
Well, I can live with that, Father. My startup has a turnover of $1 billion, I'll have you know. I have no need for your money.
I guess you're right. Listen, you couldn't lend me $100, could you? I'll pay you back soon.
Such impertinence, Father, really. Well, if you're really at your wit's end, here's 50, that's all I have on me.
That'll do nicely. That'll do nicely. Thank you. Goodbye, Joshua.
Goodbye. Good riddance.
Thank you, Jack. You are pretty good.
Pleasure. Likewise, Gideon.
You're back to your Scottish accent now,
yeah.
I see.
Yeah.
Now you speak the transatlantic accent, yeah. So go out and use it on the streets of wherever you are and let us know in the comments how it goes. Yeah. Have a good day. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.